Hello and very good evening to all of you. I'm Priyat Senivaratne and I'm the research coordinator of the Medical Faculty Research Community of Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo. A very warm welcome to the second webinar in this series of webinars which is conducted by the MFRC. The aim of these webinars is to improve the research skills, is to provide a basic foundation to undergraduate students so that they can conduct their researches better and help them to become better researchers. The first session in this series of webinars was actually focused on literature reviews, how to perform a better literature review in an appropriate sequence. You can access the recording of this website, of this webinar through our website, www.mfrc.lk. And today's session, which will be the second installment in this series, will be focusing on the development of a questionnaire. And as we all know, that is an integral part of any research, because if we get an error in our questionnaire later on, that can prove to be detrimental. And before moving on to the main session of the day, I would like to mention a few words about our advisors. The Medical Faculty Research Community was established not long ago. It was established recently. And since its inception, we've had the support of three academic advisors, and they have helped us throughout this journey, and they are the reason why we are here today. In all these activities, they have given a huge support. And today we are fortunate to have Professor Asel Olupeliyav from the Department of Medical Education, Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo, who is an academic advisor of MFRC. And I would like to invite Professor Asel Olupeliyav to speak a few words to the audience.
Thank you, Priyat. Thank you very much, Priyat. And it is a pleasure to be here today. Unfortunately, my webcam is not working, but it's a pleasure to be here today. And particularly because, although we are there for you as academic advisors, it is because of your own initiative from the students themselves that this has become a fantastically successful endeavor. And as Priyat mentioned, research skills are critical for undergraduate students. And I think we are fortunate to have an eminent speaker, Professor Kamin De Heerat, who is the head of the Department of Agro-Business Management from the University of Wayamba, and who is a professor in Applied Statistics. So I think the student leaders will introduce our speaker much more thoroughly, but I just wanted to say that it is indeed a great pleasure to have him with us today, and that statistics, having an expert in statistics is so important when it comes to the topic today related to developing questionnaires, because biostatistics and epidemiology foundations make, will focus us to ask the right questions, because I'm sure some of you who have done student research will know, but all of us know very well that when we start doing the statistical analysis, sometimes we find that, well, we haven't asked the right questions. So it is always better to know that, to understand what are the principles from the beginning. And I'm sure you will get to hear many tips of that nature from Professor Heerat. And once again, thank you very much, Professor Kamin De Heerat. And thank you very much, students, for inviting me just to speak a few words. And I'm sure this medical faculty research, student research community will grow from strength to strength. And there will be many more of these valuable events in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for those encouraging words. And now, before we move on to the main session, I would like to tell some of the ground rules for this session. If you have a question during the session, you can either raise your hand so that after the Professor Gaming would give you the opportunity, you can unmute yourself and ask, or you can put it in the chat box so that we will direct the question to the host. In the end, anyway, we would be having a Q&A session so that if you have any questions, you can ask it at the end. So without further ado, let me introduce the guest speaker for the day, Professor Kaemin Dahera, who is a professor in applied statistics, as well as the head of the Department of Agribusiness Management of University of Weinberg. He's an eminent researcher with around 60 publications and over 280 citations. And I feel that he would be the best person to give us an insight about the principles that would be important when developing questionnaires for undergraduate research. So now I would like to invite Professor Kaemin to begin the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you so much, Priyat. Good evening, all of you. Professor Asel Olupelliyawa, advisor of the Students Club Medical Faculty Research Community, and official of the club and dear students. It's actually a great pleasure, right? So getting this opportunity to address to a different community that I have been, teaching over years and years, right? And I would try as much as possible to make this discussion. So without, talking about much theory, right? So I would mainly focus on the practical aspects that you find or that helpful you to, use, developing a questionnaire to collect your data. So this is my intention because there is no point of speaking about theory over and over. I heard that, from Priya, most of you have gone through a basic statistic course, right? So most of you are from third year, and there are some students from other years as well. I hope most of you are, about to start your research for the first time in your life, right? So that's what I heard from Priya. So therefore, so I should tell you, right? I should give you certain guidelines so that would lead you to a great success, right? So in your research. So before talking about how the questionnaires are prepared and what are the tips for it and what are the ways and means that you should use, so I should draw your attention into certain important things that you might have learned so far. Okay, let me share the video, share my slides at the moment. Right, okay. All right, give me a minute, please. Right. So this would be my topic, right? The questionnaire-based survey. And I would, happy to see, right? Or happy to let you know how to collect your data properly. As Professor Asel Olupelliyawa said, very correctly, right? If you do not collect data properly, that would be really detrimental on your research. So whatever the outcome, so will be incorrect, right? So in simple, right? So if you input garbage, the output would also definitely garbage, right? So therefore, you should take care to input golden to get an golden outcome, right? So therefore, so this is not something actually hard, right? So usually when we talk about statistics, right? So people don't like statistics, right? So a lot of people are suffering from statistic anxiety, right? They don't like statistics as well as the people who teach statistics. There are a few reasons, so with this as well, statistics is sort of a language that helps you to read or understand information in the data. So data itself does not give you any information, right? So you need to read information in the data using the language, what is called statistics. So this is my definition of statistics. You know, so we find a bit harder, right? When we are going to learn a new language. So that may be the reason why, right? So there are a lot of people do not like statistics, but so if you work hard, right? So this would definitely become an interesting subject. Okay, well, so let me briefly explain. So a little bit about the research process, right? So this is pretty important for those who first time start your research. So usually the people are very hurried to start the research. They are in a very hurry, right? To start their research, to collect data and do something. So this is actually, asking for problems. So first of all, so you should design your research. First of all, you should design your research. You need to identify your research problem. You need to set your objectives and the hypotheses. So you need to have a good understanding about the theories that that are associated with your work. And so what approach or what methodology that you are going to follow? So what are the measurements? What are the variables? How you are going to measure? So how you are going to execute the research? And how you are going to analysis of your data? So different data is analyzed by different tools. Different data. So I analyze by different tools. So therefore you should know. So all about data. So before you collect data, you should definitely should have a plan, should have clearly understood the way how you are going to analyze and what would the outcome as well, right? So therefore, you need to take a considerable time to design your research before it is executed. So once the research is designed pretty well, properly, the execution of it is pretty easy because everything is documented. So everything has been defined. It's just a matter of following what you have well defined. So therefore in the next step, so you will be executing it. So in the next step, so you'll be doing data analysis. So here, data processing, data cleaning, data coding, so all included. So in the data analysis part. So before the analysis, you need to condition your data. You need to, condition your data so that your data fits into your analysis. So these are the things that usually we would do, during the analysis, the process of analysis. So once the analysis was completed, so you need to interpret your results, do report and publish your work. So then only it completes the research process. Well, all right, so well, now, so you know that, so we need to define the research problem pretty well, right? So we need to define, we need to write down the protocol, the data collection, the coding, so data checking, data analysis, interpretation, right? Reporting all, right? So I included under these four steps in the research process. All right. So here, right, the objectives and the hypothesis is pretty much matter when you are going to, develop the questionnaire. So therefore, next I would focus on the objectives of your research and the hypothesis. I should say certain things importantly about the research objectives and the hypothesis. So please note that you need to well define your research objectives, right, prior to do the research. So if you go with a weaker definition of your objectives, right, definitely your project will be a failure. That will not so provide you fruitful outcomes. A good objective is a SMART, right? So we call a good objective is SMART. So remember that S for specific, M for measurable, A for achievable, R for relevant, and T for time bound, right? So remember that. So in a research, right, you would address very specific, right, very specific objectives. So if your objectives are broader, right, so it will be a problem. You will find a lot of difficulties on getting it. So on the other hand, your objective should be measurable. So if it is not measurable, we can't then achieve it, right? So on what you are going to collect data, it's questionable. So in the same time, the objective should be something that can be achievable. So if you go with unachievable objectives, so which is a very complicated and heavy one, again, right, we will not be able to achieve it. Right? Again, asking for problems. So in the same time, the objective should be relevant to your study. If your objective is irrelevant, so to your research problem, again, you will be in trouble. So in the same time, research project also a project, right? So which can be managed based on the management, project management principles. So any project is a time-bound entity or time-bound thing. So therefore, you should be able to, you know, complete, the achieve the objective within a well-defined time frame. So therefore, we do not go for objectives so which will not be achievable within the given time frame. For an example, right? So in your third year research, maybe, right? So you will be given a certain time to complete the research. So otherwise, you will not be evaluated, or you will be given a less grade. So therefore, you have been given a target to complete within a certain time period. All right. So why do we have SMART objectives? So remember, right? So this is the important point I want to show you, right? How important defining, right? How important making the objective SMART. So this defines the focus of your study, right? The objective definitely defines the focus of your study. If you do not have a focus, you'll be going here and there and end up with nothing or something garbage. So it will clearly define the variables to be measured. So what is to be measured is directly related to the objectives. So therefore, I said you that the objective should be measurable, right? So it defines what you are going to measure. So it indicates the various steps to be used. So during the research, it shows you, right? So what are the steps that you should follow? So we will define all the activities, right? So based on the objectives, such that the objectives can be achieved. So everything is set, right, on top of the objectives, right? The objective is set on top of your research problem, all right? So it establishes the limits of the study as well. It says that, so this is the boundary, right? This is the scope, right? This is the boundary. So where are we work, right? It puts at a boundary as to work that makes our work very easy. We know the boundary where we are working. We will not be going here and there outside the boundary. So we are within the boundary. Then we will come up with good outcomes from your research. The other important thing, our objectives to be smarter. So it avoids collection of any data. So that is not statistically necessary, or that is not strictly necessary. You know, this is something mostly go wrong. So when people, you know, set their questionnaires, the people are always greedy of getting things. So this is the human nature, right? We are greedy. So when we, you know, figure out, or when we develop our questionnaire, So we feel, well, we want to put this, we want to put that questionnaire, this questionnaire, we want to collect this data, that data. So ultimately, your question will be a very messy, very long one, for which the respondent would not like to respond. So that problem is there. A lot of people are greedy for data. Don't be greedy. Collect only what supports your objectives. Do not collect any drop of data which does not support your objectives. All right. Now, so importantly, so once the objectives are set, so you need to formulate your hypothesis. Right? I think in your, you know, first statistic course, you might have heard about two kinds of hypotheses: the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis, right? The null and the alternative. Okay, the null and the alternative hypothesis, right? So H naught is a null, HA or H1 is the alternative. So usually we define a research hypothesis, right, as a specific, clear, and testable proposition or predictive statement about the possible outcomes of your scientific research. So remember that, right? The research hypothesis is directly connected to your alternative hypothesis. Usually when you report, or when you do write your report, research report, so some people so mention both the null and the alternative hypothesis. So depending on the hypothesis, so we would define, so what statistical tool that we are going to test the hypothesis, right? This is the importance of setting the hypothesis. Therefore, so please, so when we do your research, so don't forget to formulate hypothesis. Right? So if you correctly formulate your hypothesis, you can very clearly identify what are the tools that you are going to use to analyze the data. So you can set exactly what data you are going to collect and what tools that you are going to use to analyze the data, right? What procedures. So this makes clear, once you set these things, right, you know, half of your research is done. No problem. Right, the things becomes very easy thereafter. So remember that. So what is the difference between null and alternative hypothesis? Usually, so what is established currently in general, so will be taken under the null hypothesis. So what we get to see from the research is usually comes under the alternative hypothesis, right? So these are the general things, right? General understanding of null and the alternative hypothesis. I said to you that I'm not going to talking about the theory. There won't be any equation, right? So there won't be any concept, there won't be any theory that I would speak, so during my speech. Okay, so I would just tell you the tips, the points that definitely would help you to get your research. All right, so remember that you need to collect data, right, that only support your objectives. Don't collect any data point other than that. Don't do it, right? You will be feeling greedy, but don't get caught, right? You need to give up to some extent. All right, so let me introduce, right? So what are the different kinds of data? If you don't know the different kind of data, so you will be finding difficult, so when you set the questionnaire, even when you are going to present your data and analyze your data. So you might have heard about the graphical summary measures and the numerical summary measures. There are different graphical summary measures for different kinds of data. Certain graphical measures does not go with certain categories of data. So they have developed specifically for a specific set of data. So therefore, if you use a tool that is used to demonstrate or display categorical data for displaying numerical data, So it will be very ugly. I have seen that even our professors, eminent scientists, do this mistake. Right? If you go back and read your read research papers, you will see that you would see that certain people have used the graphical measures developed for categorical data or some other set of data for sometimes ratio data or continuous data. All right. Similarly, right, so we use different tools for different kinds of data. Therefore, it's very important to remind you at this point. So a little bit about the topology, the typology of the data. The one division is the qualitative and the quantitative data. The qualitative data so provides you, you know, just a feeling, you can't measure it. The quantitative data in simple terms, you can measure it. You can quantify it. Pretty easy. The other nomenclature is, right, categorical versus numerical data. The categorical data, so they are in categories. So mostly they are characters. The numerical data are the numbers. The numerical data are the numbers. For the moment, right? I would say, right, so what are the similarities and what are the differences later. The other one is the discrete and the continuous data. These are the different typologies that people use, right? So in the field, discrete and continuous data. The discrete data, data you can see as pockets, as packets. The continuous data are continuing each other, right? So there are no gaps between the consecutive data points. So they are continuous. With the continuous data, you are not able to make point measurements, right? So with the continuous data, you will not be able to make point measurements. But with the discrete data, you can make point measurements very correctly. So there is another classification, internal and external data. Internal and external data. The internal data, so mostly the data relevant to your organization. And the external data are the data outside your organization. So these are mostly used in financial statistics. And you know, marketing and other statistics, right? Usually, I have not seen so this classification in medical statistics. The one most systematic type of classification is the scales of measurements introduced by Stanley Smith Stevens, right? So that is the scales of measurements. So there are four kinds of scales of measurements by Stanley Smith Stevens, by Stevens. So they are normal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. So this is what I want you to remember, right? So be very clear on, so this classification, nominal, ordinal, and interval ratio, right? So this is very important. So when you talk about, or when we talk about the construction of questionnaires. Okay. So we will classify the data into this four group depending on four characters. Depending on four characters. One is the identity. The second one is the magnitude. Third one is the interval between two consecutive data points. The fourth one is presence of an absolute or true zero. Right? So depending on the characters that they have, the information in the data will be different. The nominal scale data carries the least amount of information. So while the ratio scale data carries the highest amount of information. Please note that you can convert, right, higher order categories into lower order categories. We can fold them down, but we cannot expand lower order categories into the higher order categories. So this is something that you should understand. Okay. I hope it makes sense, right? I don't want to you know, so take much more time. So on this, since I believe that, so you have covered this in your basic statistics course, right? So be aware of these things. Okay. So in the same time, you need to understand what is a variable, what is a variable, and what is a indices. The variable is a simple character of a population, so which can be easily measured. So that can be directly measured, so by a one unit of measurement, right? But there are certain characters, right, of a population, so which is very difficult to measure. So there will certain indicators or certain measurements or certain kinds of measurements involved in measuring the particular character, complex character. So therefore, to explain the particular character, the complex character, we will integrate the information from multiple characters into one, so which is called as an index, right? Which is called as an index. So we integrate, right, the information in several variables into one variable, so which we identify as an index that explains a particular complex phenomenon that we measure. So that is one simple example is body mass index, right? So it shows the growth of people, right? The growth is not only the height, not only the weight, so not only the circumference of your waist, right? So all together will tell you about the growth. So therefore we need, so it's hard to measure the particular character growth. So therefore when we develop questionnaires, you should have a reasonable understanding about the data, because you are going to collect the data. If you don't have a proper understanding about what you are going to collect, so it's again asking of problems. That will be a big problem. So therefore, first you should know what you are going to collect. You should know all about the data. So what are the categories? What are the characters? What are the strengths and weaknesses? So that should be there. Usually, the data in nominal and ordinal scales are categorical in nature. Categorical in nature. The nominal data, qualitative. Nominal data, qualitative. Right? The data in interval and ratio scale are mostly numerical data. They are quantitative data. But we cannot say necessarily that data in interval and the ratio scales are continuous data, right? So in the interval and the ratio scale, you would find both discrete and continuous data. The nominal data are always discrete. Ordinal data also are always discrete, right? So they are categories, they are groups. So if you think of the number of students, right? If you think of the number of students, the number of students is a discrete measure, but which is in the ratio scale. We don't have 1.5 students, right? So we have 1 student, 2 student, 3 students like that. We don't have in between, right? 1 and 2. We don't have 1.5, right? Okay. So you must understand this pretty well prior to collect data. So there is a connection between the type of data and how they are collected. I hope it makes sense. If somebody wants to ask any question, even in between my talk, I'm more than happy to listen to them. Anybody can interrupt me anytime and ask question if you wish to do so. I'm okay with that, right? All right. Well, so let me show you the different methods of collecting data. Right, so we are going to talk about here how the data is collected by a questionnaire. By using a questionnaire. So if you collect data of the population completely, that process is called a census. So in a census also, so we would use a questionnaire, right? But using a questionnaire, so we will collect information of all individuals in the population. So that process is called a census. But collecting all informations, right? All information in the population or covering all individuals in the population is a cumbersome process. Maybe we don't want to do that. Maybe we don't have time. Maybe we don't have enough resources. Maybe we don't have money. Maybe we don't have people, right? Maybe we want to do our research in a short period of time, so which is not adequate to cover the total population. So therefore, what we do is we cover a part of the population. The part is called a sample. So if you do a survey with the sample, so that will be called a sample survey. The mostly, right, in research, what people do is sample surveys. So usually we use the surveying word for the sample surveys, collecting data of a sample from a population. Surveying. So there are other methods of, generating, getting data. So we do trials, we do experiments in the real time, and we do collect data. So sometimes we do observing, or we do inspect and collect data. We examine the patients and collect data, right? We examine and collect them. So they're, the size of the parts, maybe the color of the certain parts. So maybe the texture, right? So I have seen that the doctors, right? So they touch the body and feel the internal organs and say, so this is swollen. So there is some problem, right? You inspect and collect data. So a trained person can tell how large a particular organ inside the body, right? So they can have a certain, guess about that. So even that, so we can have discussions, we can do participatory methods. So there are a lot of methods that we collect data in research, right? So usually in the community medicine and the clinical trials, so, health trials, health experiments, the survey methods, so all these methods apply, right? All these methods apply in medical research as well. The participatory things, focus group discussions, inspection, the examining, the experiments, the surveying, all applies, right? Everywhere in the research. All right, so now, so let's, focus on our topic, right? So about questionnaire surveying. Right? Questionnaire surveys. So there are two kinds of questionnaires. So based on how we are going to administer it, right? So there are questionnaires that is administered by a second party, right? So there is a person who asks questions. So there is another person who gives us reply. So that person is the person who asks the questions will be the enumerator. The person who give us the information would be the informant. So that would be the subject, right? So those sort of, surveys are called enumerator-driven surveys. So there are certain surveys. So we ask the informant to fill it. So we do the surveys using a questionnaire. We ask the informant to fill it by himself or herself. So these are called self-enumerated surveys. So this matters when you are going to develop your questionnaire, right? This matters pretty much when you are going to develop your questionnaire, right? So you have to be very careful. So when you develop a self-enumerated survey, self-enumerated questionnaire, so that must be pretty clear to the person who fill it. So with the enumerator driven surveys, right? we train the enumerator. So with the question, yeah. So certain ambiguities are welcome. So we can come up with certain abbreviated forms. We can present certain questions in simple form, abbreviated form. So because we train the enumerators, right? So they are well trained to do so. But the informant is not well aware about the questionnaire, right? If the informant is difficult to understand the questionnaire, so they will not actually fill it. The non-respondent rates would be very high. There would be a lot of non-respondents. So I would tell you later, right, what happens if there are non-respondents. That's also a big problem that you should solve before you go to the field to collect data. These are very important points. So depending on the way you administer, right, so there are different, kinds of service. Face-to-face service, the telephone service, mail and email service, and internet-based service. You know, right? So you can put simply a Google form, right? And so, you know, email it or email the link and ask the person to fill it using the Google web. Okay, Google form. The face-to-face interviews are telephone interviews. So both of them are enumerator-driven things. The mail, email, and the internet-based surveys are mostly self-enumerated ones. So depending on the nature of the questions, so there is another classification. There is another kinds of questionnaires. The structured questionnaire surveys. Here the questionnaires are well-defined. Both the questions and the answers are well-defined, right? The question is well-defined and answers are also set, right? But in the semi-structured questionnaires, so there are some questions where the answer is not set. The informant is free to provide certain answers as they wish, right? So they are called semi-structured questions. So if you use the semi-structured, it would be a semi-structured questionnaire survey. If you use a structured questionnaire, then it would be a structured questionnaire survey. So you need to know about these things. So before you develop your questionnaire, you should know what you are going to develop, right? For what purpose? For what kind of survey, right? දැනගෙන ගියොත් තමයි කතරගම යන්න පුළුවන්. නොදැන ගියොත් අතරමඟ නේද? So therefore, so you need to know all these things. Insa, I wish, right, all of you would go back and refer to your statistic notes, and you would read. So remember that, right? So this. The reading makes a man perfect, right? So this is something very famous statement. This is a very famous statement, right? Reading makes the man perfect. If you don't read, if you don't like reading, don't do research. So definitely, if you would like to do your research successfully, you must read, right? You must read and understand. Therefore, even you can forget your notes. So there are a lot of literature, there are a lot of reading materials and videos available in the Google web, in the Google sites. So there are a lot of books are available. So if you can find some time, please read it. Just have a Google search and read. And relate that with your notes. Then you will be able to find the correct materials to read from the web, right? Okay, so then I want you to read a lot. So if you wish to do your research with great success. Okay. Questionnaires in medical research. So we are approaching the target, right? So in medical research, right? In clinical research and the community medicine, the data is mostly gathered based on the questionnaires and the interviews. So even when you examine a person, right? A patient. So you do an interview. You do observations and you do interview and you collect data. The validity of the results depends on the quality of your instrument, the quality of your questionnaire. Good questionnaires are difficult to construct, while bad questionnaires are difficult to analyze. So therefore, don't be hurried to collect your data. Take a reasonable time to come up with a good questionnaire, because you will collect data, but at the end of the day, you will not be able to analyze it. You will not be able to achieve your objectives. You will not be able to generate the expected outcomes of your research. The bad questionnaire is easy. Easy to do, easy to implement. You will be able to do it quickly, but it's difficult to analyze, right? So note that it's a bit difficult to design a questionnaire for several reasons, right? You need to ask the question, you need to format the question, or you need to word the question such that unfamiliar person can read and understand, or unfamiliar person can listen and understand. The question should be able to be explained by the enumerator so that the informant can understand. So therefore you need to, right? So very well, the format, the question, the language, right? It should be formatted so that anybody can understand very easily. So there may be bad questions. So there may be sensitive questions. There may be certain questions, if you ask him, the informant would get angry. You need to avoid those. So there are certain things that you cannot ask directly. If you direct the question in a straightforward manner, the informant get mad. So he would get upset. Sometimes the informant would be emotional. So as a result, he will not give you the correct data. So therefore, it's very hard, it's very difficult to design a questionnaire because of these reasons. But you can do it, right? But a bit difficult, you need to try a little bit more to get it. Okay. So the goal is to collect information which are very quality in nature. The quality means the validity of your data, the reliability of your data, the unbiasedness of your data, and the discriminating nature of your data. Right? The validity measures the quantity or concept. So that is supposed to be measured. You need to measure what is supposed to be. You need to measure it in a valid way, right? Using a valid protocol. You cannot measure it in an invalid manner. So what you measure should be reliable. So that could be reproducible in the same manner. The reliability is the reproducibility. So in other words, we could say that consistency. You should be able to consistently produce your data. The unbiasedness means the accuracy. Lesser the bias, higher the accuracy. Higher the bias, lesser the accuracy. So your measurement should be so pretty close to what is expected to see, to the true value, to the population parameters. We don't know what the population parameters are. We are going to estimate them. So whatever we do estimate should be as much as closer to the true values, right? So what does it mean discriminating? So we need to be able to distinguish right? So we need to be able to distinguish the measurements between two levels, right? So you should be able to distinguish adequately between the respondents from whom the underlying level of quantity or the concept is different, right? So there may be, right, so, you know, different informants coming under different concepts. For an example, so let me explain this, right, with an example. So there are people who are treated, there may be a treated group of people, so there may be untreated group of people. So if there is no difference between the treatment and the without treatment condition, you would not see the difference, right? You will not be able to see the difference between these two groups. So therefore, right, so we need to set the treatments so that the difference can be seen, right? So if you give a mild dose of medicine to a person, so there won't be you won't see the difference between the medicine, the treated condition and the untreated condition. So then you need to set the levels that you test such that you would be able to discriminate the difference between the groups pretty well. I hope it makes sense. If you have any question, you can ask me later. So if you want any more clarifications with examples, just let me know. I'm more than happy to do it. All right. So that's the background, right? So these are the steps to design a questionnaire. So if you would follow these steps pretty well, so definitely at the end, you will come up with a good questionnaire, right? Without any difficulty. The quality questionnaire, right? The first, you need to define the objectives pretty clearly. You need to define your objective very clearly. You need to come up with objectives very clearly with a great understanding. In the second step, you need to identify variables or the information to be collected related to your objectives. You need to identify the relevant variables, relevant information to be collected. In the third step, you need to read. You need to read the current literature about the work of the other people that has been completed. There may be similar works. So it will tell you the way how you should collect this information. So how we collect data such that we can discriminate between the different groups of people. So when we set the answers, right? So we need to set answers such that you would be able to recognize two different groups without any problem. If the answers are pretty much closer, you would not see difference. You would not see any difference between different parties or different groups that we wish to study. Okay. So therefore, the literature provides us an insight. So what variables we should collect, how they should be measured, how the different levels, the answers should be set. So what would be the format that clear to the reader? So what is the protocol of, you know, training your enumerators, right? So these things can be pretty much understood by having a good literature survey. So therefore, so prior to do the, prior to compose the questionnaire, you definitely should go through the literature and see what others has done relevant to what you are going to do. Don't read irrelevant things. Read only what is relevant to your study, right? All right. So thereafter, so with the clear objectives, knowing what we are going to collect, and having a good background, what others has done, what measures, what principles, right? The different protocols, right? So with the prior experience, you start composing your draft questionnaire. You will compose it. You will have the draft, right? and revise it over and over. I will take one by one and let you know so that in detail. So thereafter you do pre-testing. So ultimately, we finalize the questionnaire. We assemble it to the final questionnaire. So these are the steps. Okay, let's take one by one. So defining the objectives. So we need to have SMART objectives, right? We need to have SMART objectives. Okay. So we need to have SMART objectives. So we, please make sure to define the target population in your objectives, right? I have, you know, talked about the objectives before, therefore I'm not going to talk much about the objectives, you know that. So we need to set the objective as SMART ones. All right, in the step two, you need to define the variables, right? So please write down a detailed list of information to be collected and the concept to be measured, so in the study. So you would be trying to, you know, define, right? Identify the attitudes, needs, behaviors, right? Or the distress, the stress levels, or any other, you know, variables relevant to your field. Sometimes demographics and some combinations of concepts. For an example, the growth. So if you want to growth, right, you would measure it with the body mass index. So then you need to collect. So all variables that used to compute the BMI. So thereafter, we would translate these concepts into variables so that can be measured. For an example, the attitudes cannot be measured by one single question. So you should ask several questions to understand the attitude. Right? So sometimes you want to understand so what the adoption of certain medical practices by the patients, how do they adapt, whether they adapt certain protocols, the expected protocols, so you know, getting certain therapies. So sometimes you prescribe certain steps to follow when certain medicines are taken. So sometimes you want to know, so what are the perceptions about the prescriptions, the procedures that you recommend to the patient to follow. So you need to ask several questions, adequate number of questions to cover the particular measurement, particular concept or the principle. So in the same time, you need to define the dependent variables and the independent variable. Usually the dependent variable is a predictor. The predicted variable, right? The dependent variable is a predicted variable. Independent variable is the predictor variables, right? So these things should be definitely understood by you. So these are the things what you are going to collect. So by the questionnaire, you need to include appropriate, the relevant questions to collect this information, right? So that should be, so at this point, your literature survey help you to understand, so what are the standard questions that you should ask to cover the particular concept. So what number of questions that you should ask, right, can be understood by having a clear literature survey. So that knowledge is required. Okay. So I said to you about the literature review, right? Okay. So you would talk about what are the questions, the mode of questions, the format of questionnaires, the how the data should be collected, things like that. So would be understood. So looking at the literature review. Okay. So now coming on to the composing the question. So there are certain things that you should follow, right? So when you are going to compose questions, you need to first determine the what kind of survey that you are going to use. So depending on that, you should ask questions. So especially when you are going to have a telephone survey, self-enumerated driven question, yeah, you would not ask most of the open-ended questions. You definitely would ask closed-ended questions, right? So when we, you know, do a face-to-face interview, yes, you are free to ask certain open-ended questions, right? So sometimes you need to provide extra details. So if you select a self-enumerated questionnaire survey, so this should be followed at the very beginning. So at the composing stage, so definitely during the planning stage, right? And when you compose the draft, so you will include more questions to eliminate later. However, you need to follow the final format even with your draft. So try to follow as much as possible the final format of your question, the formatting, right? Use the formatting as you are preparing the final version. And in the same time, note that longer the questionnaire would reduce the response rate. This problem is there. On the other hand, so please take care to place most important questions in the first half of your questionnaire. In case the informant would refuse answering to you in between the enumeration is doing. Therefore, first you need to give the priority to ask the informant the important questions. And in the same time, you need to maintain the flow naturally from one to another. So there should be a flow from beginning to the end of your questions. So that makes you very easy to ask questions. And the informant also feeling very easy to answer. If you ask questions here and there, the informant will be fed up with your questioning and will hesitate to give you the correct answers. So these are certain tips that you should understand. Okay. So let me show you certain tips how the questions are set. So when you compose your questionnaire. So I will tell you certain tips, right? So if you read, right, you can find out thousands of tips. So that helps you to get a, you know, good questionnaire. So look at the first question, right? How many cups of coffee or tea do you drink in a day? So now you are asking multiple things in a one question, right? So usually in principle, so we ask for an answer in one at a time, right? One dimension at a time. So therefore we should break this into two questions. So if you ask how many coffee or tea do you drink in a day, sometimes he will tell, well, so I would drink two coffees per day. He might forget answering how many cup of tea that the person drinks in a day. So therefore, you need to break that into two pieces and ask, right, in two questions. So like what you see in the screen. So there are certain questions, right? So that has you know, hidden assumptions. For an example, right? What brand of computer do you own? And there are two answers. So this is a multiple choice question. Two answers they are given, assuming that all people use IBM PCs and Apple PCs. They don't use others. So therefore, we should avoid hidden assumptions and make sure to accommodate all possible answers. The one solution is you can ask the question separately. Do you use IBM? Yes or no? So do you own an Apple computer? Yes or no? So that's one way of asking it. The other way, you can provide all possible options, right? So what brand of computer do you own? Some people may not have a computer. I don't own a computer. IBM, Apple, and the others. So then discovers the whole possible range of the answers. So therefore, you need to think of that as well. We should avoid hidden assumptions when we compose questions. So there are certain questions that does not match with the answers. The principle says that we need to ask the questions matching to the options that you have given as answers. For an example, have you had pain in the last week? Never, seldom, often, very often. Have you had pain in the last week? Yes or no? That would be my answer, right? It's not that relevant. It's not well connected with the answers. So you should form the question such that it goes with the answers. How often do you have pain in the last week? Then the reader can understand, well, this is the answers. These are the answers. Never, seldom, often, very often. Likewise, the person can answer. Okay, so therefore you need to take care of this as well when you prepare your question. Okay, so there are certain places that you should avoid questions having non-mutually exclusive answers, right? Right? For an example, where did you grow up? Countryside, in a farm, in a city. So people can grow in a rural area or in an urban area. The farms are in countryside. The country and the farm is overlapped. They are non-mutually exclusive. So therefore, your answer should be mutually exclusive. So therefore, you should ask the question, where did you grow up? House in a country, farm in a country, and the city. It's clear, right? It's clear. So we need to set the answers in a mutually exclusive manner. They should not be non-mutually exclusive because the person who's going to answer would be misleading. Okay, another situation, right? So usually we write the questions that will produce variability in the responses. Are you against drug abuse? Definitely everybody would say no. Is it? No, nobody say no. Everybody says, no, we are against drug abuse. Even though the person who is taking drug would say, I'm against this. They don't like to reveal. So therefore, we need to avoid questions like that because the answers are not, cannot be distinguished, cannot be separated. There is no variability in the answers. We cannot discrete them. So we need to eliminate questions like this. In the same time, so there are certain sensitive questions. So there are some hard questions. So there are some emotional questions. Those also should be avoided. If you want to ask certain emotion questions, so you need to ask it in few steps. Maybe using an indirect approach, you need to ask it. So once if you could, be very friendly with the informant, especially when you are doing a face-to-face interview, you can develop trust about you in the informant. So in a situation like that, when the trust is developed, after the trust is developed, so you are free to ask questions like that. So therefore, when you set the question, right? So we need to figure out where the questions should be included as well, that we will discuss later. So there are certain questions, right? Encourage. So when we ask the questions, we need to encourage respondents to consider each possible response to avoid the uncertainty of whether a missing item may represent either an answer that does not apply or an overlooked item. For an example, look at this, right? So which one of the following do you think increase a person's chance of having heart attack most? Right, tick one. You expect only one, right? Multiple choice question, you ask the person to choose one. So this will really avoid getting some information, important information that leads to heart attacks, because so they are asked to pick one. At least you need to ask them to multiple answers are, at least you should mention them, multiple answers are welcome. Otherwise, it will be a problem. So therefore, when you ask a question like that, so you should present it such that avoiding, right, curtailing of information, such that we can collect all information without missing anything. So then we can present the question like this: which of the following increase the chance of having heart attack? The smoking, yes, no, don't know. Right? Being overweight, yes, no, don't know. The stress, yes, no, don't know, right? So some people may not aware about these things. Some people may be aware about it, and they may be in the perception that smoking does not lead to heart attacks, right? So this is the way how it is done. Another question, right? I have little time, few more to go, right? But I hope that so we will be able to, cover everything, all right? So in these few minutes. So usually we do avoid branching as much as possible to avoid confusing respondents. Sometimes we do not, branch the questioning unnecessarily. So we should avoid branching as much as possible. For an example, do you currently have a life insurance policy? Or for an example, so do you take medicine daily? Yes or no? If not, why? Right? So you can present this question without branching it like this, if possible. Right? So we can write the question like this: how much did you spend last year for life insurance? If the person has a life insurance, so definitely he will tell the amount. If the person does not have a life insurance, he will not tell you the amount, right? But there are certain instances we need to do branching. At that point, definitely you should branch, right? Okay. So these are some tips when you are going to develop questions into your questionnaire. So during the revisions, right? So we need to shorten the questions. We need to correct the language. So we need to, change the style of asking it. So sometimes in between we will feel, right, certain questions are bad questions. Certain questions will be, emotional. So we need to avoid them. In the same time, when you are revising, you will feel that, well, so this is not the right place that you should ask the question. So therefore you need to bring that to the right place the question should be asked. So you can set the flow. You can set the flow. So that will be definitely doing. So when the revisions are done, so you need to go several cycles or several rounds of revisions to come up with a well-refined questionnaire. The other step is the pre-testing. Don't go to collect data without doing this step, right? So before you go to the field, you need to pre-test it. So you will print a couple of your questionnaires and go to the typical informants and ask the questions. So then you will find, well, so certain questions would be difficult to ask, even though, right, you will not capture. So while during the revising process, so there may be certain questions that makes the person upset. So there may be certain, answers that the person should not understand, right? So this step really help you to maintain the reliability and the validity of your questions. That would be definitely tested during the pre-testing. So at last, so you will be assembled the final questions. So there are certain programs so that are devoted for making questionnaires, SurveyMonkey, Adobe Live Cycle Diagnose 0.7, GCRC Assistance. There are different platforms which facilitate you to, create questionnaires. So you need to pay for these things, otherwise you can steal it. So these, platforms has set formats of questionnaire, right? So that facilitate us to do it. But we can do it our own as well, right? So we can do it our own. So using Excel format or using a Word format. So we can do it our own by typing. So at the top, usually we need to mention the purpose of the study. So how the data will be used, the instruction on how to fill out the questionnaires, and your policy on the confidentiality. So we need to provide this information to the informant. Well, so if you are going to do a face-to-face interview, you need not to be that cautious, right? To include more details in the top. But if this is going to be a self-enumerated one, you need to provide these things. So especially when you do medical research, you need to provide the ethical clearance, the certificate on the ethical clearance. You need to get the ethical clearance, right? So you need to mention the informants that, so you have taken the ethical clearance from the ethics committee, right? So the necessary thing should be included, right? So there are certain formats available, right? So in literature and in certain research papers, right? So you will find, right, in certain documents, in books, right? The set formats are there. So you can take these formats and modify it according to your research that fits into your research. Include identifying data on each page of a multiple page. So you need to do page numbering, right? And you need to number questions as well. So sometimes you will break your questions into segments depending on the similarity of your questions. So you will ask similar questions in the same time. So therefore, the similar questions should be placed in one place. So therefore, you need to group your questions such that it makes you to ask the questions. The similar questions will be taken into separate sections in your questionnaire. So that will really, help you to do the questionnaire very easy, maintaining a high respondent rate. All right. So you should have an ID number, like date, the place to date as well, right? Okay. So you will group, you will order question, right? So that I mentioned before. You will include the white space to make the answer clear and the help increasing the response rate. If the questionnaire is very attractive, so the people would tend to answer. If the questionnaire is not attractive, it's not clear, if the visibility is very poor, right, the respondents would not, feel to answer. They will, not like to answer. So if your questionnaire is not clear, the enumerator also finds difficulties in asking questions. So there will be enumeration errors, right? So in the same time, you need to provide the adequate space in between two questions, right? So when we have open-ended questions, right, the space between the question and the answer should be adequate. The space between, right, two questions should be adequate. In the same time, you should provide an adequate space to provide the answer. Otherwise, right, the respondent would write the answer everywhere, right? Right, everywhere in the margins of the paper as well. The enumerator would write everywhere the answer. So which will later, so making confusing, right? So when at the time you are going to enter your data, so that leads to a lot of confusions, making a lot of errors. All right. So in the same time, so when we have close-ended questions, right? So when we do line up the answers, right? So we, as much as possible, so we line up the answers into one line, right? Rather than messing up with the questions. And we would usually use large font size. The 14 is preferred, right? And then the readability of the questionnaire is very high. As a result, the respondent rate would be high. So these are some types of questions, right? So we have multiple choice questions here. So we ask the people, so there are multiple choices. So we can ask them to select one question or one answer or several answers. You need to provide the respective instructions. So there are rating scale questions. So we ask them to rate out of 0 to 10. Or sometimes we ask them to rate them out of 100. So we have Likert scale questions, right? So this is one version of a rating question. So we have a matrix questions. Suppose, we need to use 5 questions to test a certain concept. So we can collect information about one concept asking 10 questions, right? And we are going to rate it out of 10. So then the rating can be, so put in the rows, in the first row, right? And the questions can be put in your first column. And we can make it as a, we can present it as a matrix. So we can present your answers in drop-down menus. So those questions are called drop-down questions. So there will be open-ended questions. The person is the informant is free to provide the answer. So there are demographic questions, the marital status, the gender, the age, education, things like that. So there would be ranking questions. You can ask, you know, people to rank certain steps. So depending on the importance. So we can ask certain person to rank certain given points. So depending on the person's perception. So we can have image questions. We can put certain image to select. So we can have click map questions. So if you want to identify the places where the pains are received on the body, so we can put a picture of the body and ask people to mark the places where the pains are there. So we can fill upload questions. අපිට පොඩි ස්ක්‍රිප්ට් එකක් දාන්න පුළුවන් ෆිල් කරන්න කියලා half the quarter the 1/3 the නැත්නම් 1/10 likewise. So we can have a slider question, right? So we can have a sliding bar to rate them the particular sentence or particular statement, right? So you can investigate these things, right? So by reading, okay. All right, so how to enhance the response rate? So we need to, you know, ask the questions in a simple term so that the person can understand the question. So if it is going to be a self-enumerated question, yeah, you need to maintain a very clear appearance. So of the questionnaire, and we need to convince the person to importance of providing the information to this one, and we need to, you know, convince the informant the importance of doing this. So in the same time, so we can be friendly with the informant and motivate him to answer the question. Suppose it's going to be a self-enumerated one and there are non-respondents, so we can do follow-up calling, right? So you can give a call and follow up and ask person to very politely, so please fill this for me. So it's not a bad idea to contact the informants taken into the sample. You can very politely access them and ask them to fill it. So especially in an email survey, you can send them gentle reminders, please fill this. If possible, offer an intensive, which I ask you to don't do, right? If you offer an incentive, nobody would be able to get the information from our people without offering an incentive. So this is the nature of Sri Lanka. So therefore, please don't offer incentives, right? So convince them the importance of this one and delegate him and compel him to give the answers very politely. All right, so these are certain errors that can happen. So in a questionnaire survey, so if your sample does not cover the population well, there may be errors. The non-respondents error may be there. So there will be sampling errors, right? Usually, right, there is an inherent variability among the individuals in the population. The populations, the individuals taken into samples at different time will be variable. So there will be sampling errors. So in the same time, so there may be measurement errors. If you ask a bad question, the reply also would be a bad, right? So I can explain these things if we get more time, but I'm running out of the time, right? So therefore, I would like to move to the question and answering session. So with this, I have a few more things to show you up. Yes, I will show you these things. I want to little talk about sampling and the sample size and wind up. So Priya, can I get a few minutes, few more minutes?
Yes, sir, of course. You can carry on.
Okay. All right. So remember, the coverage error is very critical. So to avoid the coverage error, so we need to maintain a representative sample. We need to get a representative sample. The sample that you get should be as representative as possible. Right? So therefore, there should not be any gray areas, so where you don't have informants from the population. So by following up actions, right, in a gentle manner, so we can avoid the non-respondents error. So remember that once you select somebody into the sample, you cannot drop the person. If you drop the person, the randomness of your sample disappears. That issue is there. You cannot take somebody else near to that person. So therefore, if you select a person to the population, the person must be in the room. So this is a big problem. To avoid this one, what we do is we maintain a non-respondent rate. Suppose our sample size is 100, and assuming that the non-respondent rate of that particular population is 20%, we can add 20 more into the sample. Now we have 120 instead of 100. So then we can allow the droppings without any problem. Therefore, when you select the sample, we need to adjust your sample size to the non-respondents. This is pretty important. Otherwise, so you will have to make a very big effort to avoid the non-respondents, right? To avoid the sampling errors, so we need to do the sample. We need to select a proper sampling procedure, right? So we need to train the enumerators very well, not to ask bad questions and to convince them how to ask questions, right? So we need to definitely compulsorily do a enumerator training. you need to train your enumerators, right? You alone cannot do this. You will get together with your friends and collect the data. So you may be the person who designed the questionnaire. So then you will be the person who know about this. But if your friends are going with you to collect data, so taking the questionnaire, so please train them. Tell them all about in your mind. Don't keep anything in your mind. Reveal everything to your friends, the enumerators. So this is the way how we approach. This is the way the question is asked. This is what it means. Should be clearly mentioned to them. All right. So therefore, we need to ensure the representative sample. So for this purpose, so we need to use a proper sampling procedure, right? That appropriate to the condition of that you do the experiment. And we need to maintain an adequate sample size adjusted to the non-respondent rates. By doing so, you can maintain the representativeness at maximum. So when your population, individuals in the populations are very homogeneous, the variability among the individuals in the population is very less, and the sampling frame is available, so you could go for a simple random sampling to get a sample. So when there are certain factors, certain characters in the population that would significantly impact on our measurements, right? So we will divide the population into different strata using that factor influencing the measurements. So in a certain situation, so we will use a stratified random sampling, which you might have learned, right? I just want to say, so where we are going to apply those, right? This is what I wanted. So whenever there is no any clear sampling frame, a sampling frame is a list of individuals in the population. There are certain instances we don't have a list of individuals of the population. So especially whenever there are no sampling frame, so we would go for systematic random sampling. So we would select the first informant randomly and keep interviewing. So every 10th person coming into the counter, for an example, coming into your clinic, right? You don't have a clear list of persons coming into your clinic, right? So new persons will be there. New admissions will be there. So therefore, what we do is, right? So we take first person randomly and keep on interviewing every kth person coming into the counter. So we can go for cluster sampling. So when we have, you know, geographical barriers of, you know, for the data collection, for the enumeration. So mostly we go for cluster sampling. So which is a bit inefficient. So where we need to maintain high sample sizes. So mostly people would use multi-stage sampling. So where we do the sampling at different stages. At different stages, we are free to use different sampling procedures. Right, so which you can understand so by reading, right? I'm just introducing you to things that you should pay your attention. And we need to maintain adequate sample size. There are different samplers. So if you search, if you have a Google search, so you will see different samplers, right? You know, popping up. So if you read the research papers, so they have recommended different sampling equations, sample size calculation equations. So whatever the sampling procedure, sample size calculating procedure, you should be able to defend it. You should be able to defend it. So this is one sample calculator. So P is the variability. So A is the alpha, the type 1 error. The Z is the Z value, so which is taken from the Z table based on the level of confidence. N is the population number. So by using this is one standard equation used to calculate the sample size. So please make sure to adjust the sample size to the non-respondents. All right, this is all what I intended to inculcate in you, right, to give you at this in this speech. I hope that so you may have understood certain things or may not have understood certain things. So with certain things, you can get it clarified during the question and answering session. If you wish, right, you can even drop me an email. So depending on my time availability, I can consider giving you some reasonable answer, or at least to recommend some reference. Okay, with this, thanking again the advisor of this medical faculty research community and the officials of this club, giving me this opportunity to share my, experience with you. I hope that this might have benefited you at least a little to get your first research done very successfully. And especially I would thank Priya for inviting me to this occasion. So thank you so much. Priya, you can start answer and question session.
Thank you, sir, for that extremely information. I must say that I myself learned a lot of important principles that I didn't know before. And I believe that everyone audience would also. And another specialty is that you highlighted the theory that we have learned, how to apply it to practical scenario. And by using a lot of examples, and I believe that this would have been very useful to our students. And also, I must say at this point that the way that you taught these concepts in a very warm and caring manner is very unique. It's not something that we see every day. And it makes us realize that you actually want us as students to succeed, and not just to teach these concepts. So I thank you again for this extremely useful lecture. Now it is the time for the question and answer session. If you have any questions, you can either unmute yourself and ask, or you can post the question in the chat box. Okay, sir, we have a question. Sir, can you tell us about the types of validity which are assessed during the pretest?
Can you repeat the question, Priya?
Yes. Can you tell us about the types of validity which are assessed during the pretest?
During the?
Pretesting of the question.
The type of validity. During the pretest, right, usually, so there are no any specific the measures of validity, but so during the pretest, you will understand, so this is the way how the validity and the reliability is certain, so during the pretesting, right? During the pretesting, so it helps us to understand whether the question is understood by the informant. So whether the question, we ask the question in the right format so that the informant can understand. So during the questionnaire, during the pretesting, so we can understand some deficiencies if there are in our answers. So we might have missed certain answers. So then we can understand well. So these answers, certain answers are missed and we should include it. So sometimes our answers may be wrong. Right? So that also can be recognized during the pretesting. So in the same time, so we can recognize the time taken to complete the questionnaire. So if the time taken to complete the questionnaire is very long, the reliability and the validity of our data will be arguable, will be questionable. So especially, right, so we will be able to reveal, so whether there are bad questions, whether there are emotional questions that make the informant upset. So that also can be picked. In the same time, the informant can understand the way how we should present the question to the informant. Right? We should present the question to the informant so that he compelled to give you the right answer. So those things can be pretty much understood during the pre-testing period. So in the same time, so we will have you know, several enumerators. Suppose we have several enumerators occupied for the data collection. So this pre-testing helps us to understand the variability among the enumerators. If the variability among the enumerators is very high, again, the reliability and the validity of our data is again problem, again questionable. So therefore, during the enumeration, so during the pre-testing, so we get an opportunity to understand the variabilities that take in place, so that you get among the enumerators. So then, so we can train enumerators specially to reduce the variability among them. So these are the ways and means that help us to increase the reliability and the validity of data as a result of the pre-testing. So did you get the answer?
Thank you, sir. So then there's another question. How can we find questionnaires used in previous related researchers online? Because most articles do not come with additional materials like questionnaires that have been used.
Yes. The one way that you can get is, so if you read the question, you know, in some journals, in some journal articles, so if you go through it, you will see certain links have been provided for supplementary materials, right? Certain journals maintain supplementary materials relevant to their journal articles. So with the link is given, the supplementary materials are provided so online, right? So in the official web. So they are, so mostly the questionnaire has been made available. So that's one way that you can see. And I said that there are some computer programs, the computer packages. So we are, so a lot of questionnaire formats and the ways of asking questions are available. So if you have a simple Google search, you can find that. So these are the, you know, usual, the available ways, right, that you can get the questionnaires. So some papers, right, some journals allow the authors to publish their questionnaires in the article as an annex, so which is a bit rare, right? The mostly, so those can be found under the supplementary materials.
Thank you, sir. And there's another question. So if you are modifying and shortening a standard questionnaire for a purpose, would adjusting the cutoffs according to the ratio of questions be acceptable?
No. Don't cut off it like that. So when you are going to use a partially developed questionnaire by someone else, or a set questionnaire, right? You can't cut off. So if it is a standard questionnaire, you can cut off. So there are standard questionnaires to collect certain things. For an example, the distress level is measured by what? So what is the measurement of the distress level, Priya?
We can use several. There are several measurements like the Kessler psychological
distress. We have ODAS. We have ODAS.
ODAS, that is for disability.
Yeah, disability.
Kessler psychological distress scale, that is
yes. Psychological distress. You know, in a situation like that, right? So we need to use that set standard questionnaire. You can't curtail the questions, but you can modify or you can convert that into your language. But when you use someone else's questionnaire, so someone else's format or halfway done questionnaire, definitely you have to be very cautious. You should contact the person if possible and ask what are the limits, so what are the questions, so what is the basis of the rates, and how you have set the limits as well should be get clarified. So thereafter you can make changes such that it fits into your research. But don't directly use halfly cooked questionnaire and a set format as it is into your research. So that should be modified. So with great care, if possible, please contact the person who belongs to that and ask, you know, the references and the levels and the answers. So things like that. Well, so this is required.
Thank you, sir. Are there any more questions? You can either unmute yourself and ask or post the chat. Okay, then, in the absence of further questions, we will conclude today's session. Once again, I would like to thank Professor Kamin Dahera, Professor in Applied Statistics and Head of Department of Agribusiness Management, University of Coimbra, and Professor Asil Olupeliyaw from the Department of Medical Education, Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo, for sacrificing your valuable time amidst your busy schedules. And thank you all for joining with us today. And stay tuned with us for future talk sessions as well as for journal clubs, which will be coming up, and they will happen monthly. And the information regarding the registration will be put up in our website. So stay tuned with us, and thank you all. Good evening.